Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here down in South Carolina. God bless you guys. Hope the Lord is blessing you today, which He is. If you are a born again Christian, we are blessed and highly favored. Children of the Most High God, hallelujah, as the Lord told us in the Gospel of John, chapter 1, to whom many have received Him, to them He has given the power to become the sons of God, or children of God. Hallelujah. John chapter 1. Blessed be His holy name. Blessed be His holy name. To as many who have received Him, to them whom He has given power to become the children of God. Praise His holy name. Bless His holy name. He is worthy of praise. Hallelujah. I just wanted to show you something. A dear sister in the Lord had given me this to use to grind up some frankincense and myrrh. A mortar and pestle. You know, lots of people use these things, brothers and sisters, to grind up, besides medicine, you can use it to grind up herbs and stuff. And, you know, I got some more videos to make, and I was getting ready to make these other videos, brothers and sisters, and the Lord just told me, look at this thing. You know, and then there's a song by Jeremy Riddle. I'll put the link, I won't put an active link on the video because it's, you know, the way they've got it right now. Can't hardly do it, but I'll put the name Sweetly Broken by Jeremy Riddle, and I will put a link below this video. You can go listen to it. And that's the song that the Lord was giving me, you know. Sweetly Broken. At the cross you beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love, I'm sweetly broken, holy surrender. And it goes on. It's a great song. But brothers and sisters, it's just like this mortar and pestle here, what the Lord was showing me. You know, when you have a piece of garlic, you know, in the Philippines we use fresh garlic. And here I've been buying the fresh garlic, and lots of Filipino cooking has garlic. You know, garlic will lower your blood pressure. And it's a natural way to lower your blood pressure. As a matter of fact, I've talked to many Filipino pastors, and in the Philippines, you have to take a physical to get your driver's license. And almost, you know, the average Filipino would be lucky if they lived to 50 without a stroke. I mean, I don't know how many, but it's just so common because of all the soy sauce and pork they eat and all this, a lot of salt. And so his blood pressure was way, way high. And I'd already prayed for him and talked to him. And I was like, look, the Lord heals us, but it's just like, you know, smoking cigarettes and then asking me to pray that the Lord will heal your lung cancer. Of course, God heals us, but of course, you know, if we know to do something better, you know, like not eating too much salt or whatever it is, we should do that also. But I told him, I was like, look, eat you some garlic and go try again. His blood pressure was way up there. It was like 280 or 260 over, you know, 160 or whatever. It was way up there. And he ate 5 cloves of garlic, and then, even though, of course, I'm sure he smelled lovely, but his blood pressure was lowered, brothers and sisters. He was in the normal range. He was able to pass. So anyway, what the thing that the illustration that the Lord was showing me is that, you know, this is like what the Lord does with us, brothers and sisters. You know, He's the potter, we're the clay. There's lots of Bible verses that talk about that. You know, God told Jeremiah to go look at the potter making the clay and how he was taking that clay and shaping it. And if it wasn't right, he would smash it and do it again, smash it and do it again. And so here we are, brothers and sisters. You know, we're just like that garlic. Of course, that's probably not a great example because garlic really doesn't have a good smell. But, brothers and sisters, what does it say in 2 Corinthians? It says that to those who are being saved, we are ambassadors of Christ. Those who are speaking the gospel, so that, you know, all of us are supposed to be speaking the gospel. You know, we Christians are supposed to be just like all of us preachers in the way that we should all evangelize. Says that we are a sweet-smelling savor to those who are being saved, but, you know, we're a stench of death to those who are perishing. So, you know, and I like the smell of garlic. You know, garlic can smell good. Maybe not as a secondary smell on somebody's breath, you know, but garlic smells good when you smell it cooking and stuff, you know, and it's a sweet-smelling savor. But the thing about the garlic, well, you know, that's a whole other example. Sometimes garlic, you cook it. You put some heat on it. You know, one time the Lord showed me when I was getting ready to go through something, and I didn't know I was going to go through something. The Lord showed me like a glass beaker, like the glass jars that I will use to send out the anointing oil is a glass jar. And I'm just checking it to see if it fit into, I got some little cellophane baggies. And I put some dear sister sent me these glass vials, and I'm going to get some, another sister's made me some labels. I'll be getting those in the next week with my email address and stuff. If you have any questions about the anointing oil, go to James chapter 5 is where you read about the anointing oil. You know, if any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church, anointing him with oil, and the prayer of faith shall heal the sick. The elders should anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. So when I'm going to pray over this, and some of you who are watching this are elders. You know, all preachers are elders, but not all elders preach. So an overseer, elder in the church, I'm praying over this. I'm asking those who watch this to pray over it. And then when you go and use the oil and anoint somebody in the name of the Lord, it's as if we're there. Because, you know, that's the whole thing about the YouTube ministry, the virtual ministry. You know, I've got over 5,000 people who watch my videos, but they're all over the world. So I can't be all those places, but the Lord can. And this oil represents the prayers that were put in there. Myself and all those who watched this, who prayed over that. So it could be thousands of people. I will say this. I would say there's a good 10%. Let's just say there's a solid, 1,000 prayer warriors who prayed over that oil. Can you imagine that? You can't go to a church and get hardly 1,000 people lay hands on you and pray. You know, and the Bible says 1,000, one can put 1,000 to flight, 2, 10,000. So you multiply that. 300,000, right? 4, 1,000,000. You know, we're talking about evil, we're talking about demons and all that, wicked people and demons and stuff, the Bible tells us. So when we come in agreement, you know, we have that power and authority in Christ together, brothers and sisters. That's what this oil represents, a point of contact. There's no oil in here yet, but there will be. But I need to make another video. You know me, I can't stay on topic. But anyway, brothers and sisters, the Lord had shown me a vision of a glass tube, like a test tube. This is similar to that without the screw top. You know, and the Lord showed me he was putting it over that Bunsen burner, heating it up. So when you take garlic and you cook it, it has a great smell too. When it's heated up, when you put the heat to it, and God will put the heat to us sometimes. And then the second illustration, or my first illustration to be exact, is the garlic. You know, when you take some cloves of garlic, really don't have too much smell. I don't know if you've ever done that. Maybe to nowadays, no one is cooking from scratch, and we should use herbs. You could go get you some mint. You know, there's people that grow their own little herb garden and all that. That is awesome. There's nothing to replace that. It's even the nutrients and all that that's in organic stuff and natural stuff you grow yourself is 1,000 times more than buying the powdered stuff at the store. Lots of people don't have time. But if there's something in the natural that you want to make time for, that's a thing to have your own natural stuff like that. Even in your house, I think you can have little potted plants. I'm not doing it. When I settle down, by the grace of God, you know, it's a neat little hobby. Grow your own little herbs and stuff. And anyway, you can use one of these pestles here and and mortar, and you put it in there and you grind it up. And anyway, brothers and sisters, when you grind it, it releases the fragrance. And that's the little message I'm trying to give in this video. I'm getting to it, that when you cook something and heat that garlic up, it actually smells good to me. You know, you can have other ingredients. You know, it has that smell when it from raw to cooked, when you God puts the heat to you and puts you through the fire. You know, you have that sweet smell that is a sweet savor in the nostrils of the Lord, and to those who are being saved, to those who will receive you in Christ, it's a sweet savor. And then there's the times where the Lord will crush you and break you and grind you, but when he does it, it's releasing the aroma that's in you. And brothers and sisters, there's a mistake that some people make. They give up, and all this condemnation, and that's a whole other video I want to make, but let me just do a Sunday sermon. Just go with it. Now, there's a particular brother I'm thinking about, but he's not the only one. There's lots of people. It's all this legalism and self-condemnation. Self-condemnation. Make one little mistake. Oh, God's thrown me away. God's done with me. Now, God's not going to use me anymore. And all this self-condemnation. And when I was up there in the mountains of North Carolina, up there in the Appalachian Mountains, I ran up there. And it's nice. You know, it gets old running in a flat place. Where I lived in the Philippines, the last few years, I was in a real flat place right by the ocean. And here, it's flat. So, I mean, it's great in a way, you know, but it gets old. It's nice to have a variety is what I'm saying. And going to different places. And in the mountains, of course, it's a serious challenge. It's it's a whole lot harder to run up a hill than it is in a flat place. But, of course, the beauty of hills, this is all related to the same message, brothers and sisters. You know, think spiritually. Think metaphorically, okay? The beauty of running up hills, you know, is there's times that you get, to, you know, when you come back, you run back downhill. So if you started at an elevation of 1,000 feet and you ran to an elevation of 3,000 feet, you know, and you're going to go back where you started, you know, you get to come back down. So that's the beauty of running in heels, is that you're doing double duty for a season, but then there's a season where you're just coasting. You know, the wind's at your back and you're coasting. Whereas on a flat place, you have that steady flow of resistance, and then the steady flow of the wind at your back, basically unchanging of the elevation. You see what I'm saying? I'm talking spiritual. And you know, the Lord is so awesome, brothers and sisters. If you knew that when I started this video, I wanted to talk about the deceptions of the enemy, and then the Lord showed me this thing, and he told me to get this thing and talk about the Lord grinding you for a sweet smelling savor. And I had no idea. You know, brothers and sisters, all the videos I make, if you just knew that, I have no idea in advance, you know, what I'm going to say. I'll just have one point I'm going to start with. If you can only know that, and I've said it, and, you know, I know that, you know, those of all but a few people can understand what I'm saying. It's the amazing thing of the Lord connecting all things. So as I'm saying, there are times when you are crushed. There's times when the Lord puts the heat under your behind, and there's the times when you got to run uphill. You know, and those things are all connected. And just till now that I know it, praise be to God for His Spirit, you know, that guides, you know, me. And that's what I try to do in my videos, brothers and sisters. I just try to be led by the Lord. I'm saying it now, but you know, I make all those videos and it just connects. And other people say, well, that is really awesome, but and the Lord did it. It's not me, but Him that lives in me. It's Christ within me. It's Him that's doing it. And He's the one who does the work. And He'll do it in you too, brothers and sisters. We all have our different callings and talents, whether it be to be a businessman. I say this all the time. Or if the Lord wants you to do a blog or videos, there's lots of people trying to do videos, and some of them, you know, are called, and some of them should not be making videos. And there are other people who are not making videos who should be making videos. You know, so that's why I should let, you know, answer the call of the Lord in your life. And yes, He's going to put you through the grinding. You know, that's the problem with most people. They want to take the easy way. They want to take the high road. You know, it's like Lot and Abraham. And I was just looking at that the other day and wasn't even looking at this topic. I was, see how the Lord is? I was just reading and listening to, an audio version, you know, the audio on the internet of the story of Abraham and Lot, because the Lord had told me to. You know, Genesis, in that particular section. And I didn't even think about it. It's related to this message too. Of course, Lot chose the plain, the nice area, the flat area, the beautiful watered area. And Abraham, you know, being much greater than Lot, but yet he let Lot, who was A, younger than him, you know, B, his, like his nephew, C, of course, Abraham was a spiritual prince and a mighty man of God, but yet he let Lot choose over himself. In the grace of God, just like God does, you know, Abraham being a type of the Father, you know, Father Abraham, the Bible calls him, and a type of the Father, just like when he went to sacrifice Isaac, he was a type of the Father. So Abraham went there and let Lot choose where he would go and separate from him. Of course, there's all the time people will teach a lesson of how, you know, Lot's mistake was separating from his uncle who was so blessed. But the message I'm saying right now is that Lot took the low, you know, the high road, actually, in this case, the low road. You know, like the old Irish song, you take the high road, now take the low road. And so Lot took what looked to be the best, but it was Sodom and Gomorrah. Just his tents were pitched towards Sodom and Gomorrah. And then Abraham was way far away. Like the video I made, you know, the Lord showed me who would be raptured and who would be not. I used that same text. You should see it if you've not seen it. Brothers and sisters, search it on my channel, or you can search it on YouTube. The Lord showed me who would be raptured and who would be not, and the message that the Lord gave me. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so, you know, the reason why most people are not doing God's will is because they don't want to go through the process. And then there's other people who try to bypass it. Now, I want to say this because I know one brother who was supposed to serve the Lord, supposed to be in the ministry, is backslid and an alcoholic for 40 years and all this stuff, even ran a bar, all this kind of stuff. You know, he ran a bar, which if you're in the world, I mean, they say it's a great way to make money. If you want to party, hey, why not own a bar? You can make money and stay drunk all the time, you know. So this brother did that, and now that brother, who he's given his testimony before, is a mature man of God, and he knows, you know, that God is using him, and he knows that, hey, I missed all these years, and now's a chance for me to redeem the time. But, you know, I know that I got to still go through that process that I should have went through 30 or 40 years ago of being crushed and having the heat put under me you know, and God is just, you know, speeding up the time and redeeming the time. And this brother is, and I've worked with this brother, I guess I should say his name, and because I've talked about him before. He's the one who's the administrator on the website, Church of the Firstborn, Brother Sid. And Brother Sid is a very mature man of God. You know, since he came back to the Lord in 2006, his testimony is he had a heart attack, and the Lord gave him a choice. You know, hey, well, you know, you'd be in hell right now if you died. And, you know, I should videotape Brother Sid telling his testimony. It's awesome. And the Lord has used him awesomely, you know, with people who are alcoholics and things like that. That's why, you know, that's why he's so good with the intercessory prayer team on Church of the Firstborn. He can feel your pain. He's been there and done that more than lots of people. Yet he's humble in knowing that he missed all those years and he must redeem the time and still go through processes, but the Lord would give him a speedier course because, of course, he's not a young man anymore, in his 60s, and so, of course, he would have to go through a faster process because he also mature and you know, not he's, you know, he's more mature and experienced in his life, just naturally living as your life. You know, you're more mature the older you get, and that helps. That does help in the practical side of the ministry. Anyway, brothers and sisters, and there's another brother almost in the same boat. You know, or lots of people. I won't just say one brother. Lots of people who think they can go from 0 to 100 miles an hour in a day without going through that process, without going through the crushing, without going through the heating, without going through the process that God would put them through. You can't do that, brothers and sisters. You cannot do that. And many people don't serve the Lord because they don't want to go through the process. Submit yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and He will give you strength, the Bible says. He will strengthen you. He will guide you. He will lead you by His Spirit. So that's why I tell you today, will you please surrender all to the Lord, every part of your life? Just like the song says, all to Jesus I surrender. All to Jesus I surrender. That's what it says. All to Thee I freely give. I'm trying to think of the words. All to Thee I freely give. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. Surrender all to Jesus today. Stop fighting against the Lord. Stop kicking against the pricks, as the King James says. And it's not a bad word. It's the goads, as the NIV says. Paul is like an oxen who was pulling a cart, and the driver of the oxen, the Lord kept poking him in the behind with a goad to goad someone. King James uses the word to prick because it prick your skin. It's a pointy stick. And it's Paul, the Lord Jesus told Paul, it's hard for you to keep kicking against the goads. And that's what most of you have been doing. The Lord's been trying to goad you to do His will. And most of you don't want to go through the process. You don't want to be embarrassed. You don't want to be crushed. You don't want to be hurt. You don't want to sacrifice. And then there are a few of you, like I said, a few who think that day one you're the boss. And I have those same people contacting me that they're all Moses. They're all Elijah. They're all the priest, the last priestly prophet. They all think, you know, they have a messianic complex. You know, and that's where your false prophets and cults come from. But the majority, I mean, there's few and far between of those guys. I mean, everybody knows, hey, you know, everybody knows that they're out of bounds. It's pretty common, except for their followers, you know, like you end up with Jehovah's Witnesses and the Mormons and this kind of thing because they were really good. But most of your false prophets are not really that good at getting people to follow them, you know. But there are a few who are master deceivers, and that's the other video I need to make about the deceptions of Satan. But anyway, brothers and sisters, the majority of you is not wacky and mentally disturbed. You just don't want to surrender your lives. You know, your life, your own personal will is more important than God's will. And that's what I've said many times. You need to have your Garden of Gethsemane moment. When you say, Lord, not my will be done, but Thy will be done. Lord, if it's possible, let this mortar and pestilence pass from me. Let this flame under my behind pass from me. Let these goads of sharp pokes on my behind for me to go as a mule, as an ox, to move and pull the load that you've given me to pull, let this pass from me. But nevertheless, not my will be done, but Thy will be done. You need to have a Garden of Gethsemane moment. You need to surrender all to the Lord. That's the secret of serving the Lord. That's the secret of seeing miracles, signs and wonders, and the fruition of the vision that the Lord gave you coming to pass. You have to plant it. Jesus said, if you have a seed and it's not planted, it abides alone. Jesus said this right before the Last Supper in John, when he knew his time had come to depart out of this world. It said he loved his own until the end. And he said, except the seed fall to the ground and die, it abides alone. What was he saying? You know, you plant a seed and it sow, you know, and it reaps 30, 60, 100-fold. He was talking about himself. God had no earthly family. We were separated from him by sin. What did he do? He sowed a seed into the earth. He planted, literally planted his son, his only begotten son. He planted his son in the ground. Jesus was literally planted in the cave for 3 days and three nights, in the earth for 3 days and three nights. God planted him. And then what? He came forward. And what did he do? He produced a mighty harvest. It's called the church, brothers and sisters. But first, Jesus had to be crucified. He had to die before he could be resurrected and bear much fruit. Just like a corn. That's what Jesus was saying, a piece of wheat. If you just take that one piece of wheat and lay it there, it ain't going to do nothing. That piece of wheat has to be planted to grow more wheat and produce a harvest of wheat or corn. That's what Jesus is talking about. You hear the prosperity people talking about money. That's true. It's also true. When you give, it'll be given into you. In good measure, pressed down and running over, will men give into your bosom, the Lord Jesus said. Luke chapter 7. God loves a cheerful giver. For the same measure you measure with and give with, it'll be given back to you. That's the same thing. The more seed you sow, the more you reap in all things, brothers and sisters. The more love you sow, the more love you reap. The more joy you sow, the more joy you reap. The more gospel you sow, the more salvations that come. The more finances you sow, so the Lord will bless you more financially. That's God's system in all things, brothers and sisters, in all things. We are a walking seed bank. Crucify your flesh and sow the seed that God gave you. Sow your talents into the kingdom of God. There's many of you that can do that can do internet stuff, IT stuff. What do you do for the Lord? Nothing. There's many of you with advanced wisdom and counseling. You've been married for 50 years. You can be great at counseling young couples who are having trouble, ready to get divorced. But instead, when the church asks you, hey, can you be an altar worker for us and counsel young couples? Oh, no, I'm just too busy. I can't do that. And that's not just a church. It's like the online church we have. Church of the Firstborn. We have another person at it. So we have 13. Praise God. A sister volunteered, said she wanted to be on it. And Brother Sid and I will see, you know, we interview the people and make sure that they're, you know, mature in the Lord to do it. Because, you know, it's hard to know people through the internet. So by the grace of God, we have 13. Out of all the people that watch my channel, 13 intercessors. Lots of people, you know, there are people who intercede that's not part on that list to receive the prayer request alerts for people who ask for a prayer request. It's mailed out to all those people who have volunteered to be intercessors for Joshua's ministry. There's no reason why we shouldn't have 1,000 intercessors on there. Brothers and sisters, stop doing your own will. There are people that love to make excuses of why they don't donate to any church, any ministry, whether it be Joshua's ministry, the orphanages, or the feeding programs, or Samaritan's Purse, or whatever. They always have some excuse. Well, I don't like Brother Patrick because I don't agree with what he says about the rapture. Okay, I don't know what that's got to do with orphans and feeding street children and advancing the gospel in the Philippines and even, you know, the ministry that Lord would use me in the States to take the gospel in the States. Or I don't know what it's, what it's got to do with Samaritan's Purse. I've had lots of people tell me, well, I don't want to give to so-and-so ministry because, I don't like whomever it is. John Hagee, let's say an example. Well, why don't you give to Samaritan's Purse? Oh, you don't like Billy Graham? You don't like Franklin Graham? Okay, why don't you find another ministry to give to? I mean, stop making excuses. You know, I'm just so busy. I can't be on a prayer team. You know, I can't do this. I can't do that. People make all kinds of excuses for everything, anything to be all about me, all about themselves. That's what they're all about themselves. And that's what really worries me. We're talking about the fact that the rapture is close, that the rapture is at hand. And many of you believe that, but yet. You are sowing no seeds in any way. You are sowing no seeds in the kingdom of God. Everything you got is about me, myself, and I. Maybe your heathen relatives, you exalt your heathen relatives, maybe, and give them everything they want. But not given to the maimed, the halt, the poor, the blind, as the Lord said. You know, and there's a dear brother who's an attorney in Las Vegas. This dear brother goes out there and does a street ministry, prays for people to be healed, gives meals, even a place to stay, to homeless people, and all kinds of stuff. a brother don't, you know, the brother has made a few videos, and I've liked his videos to send them out. You know, but this brother, he said that all the churches he went to, he didn't like nothing that none of them were doing. Fine. And he rightly so. What did he do? He went out and did his own ministry. Amen. Praise God. That's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to be doing our own ministry. And if we're so busy, suppose you're a businessman and you're so busy working, well, fine. That's what you do. You give to those who God called to do ministry. Samaritan's Purse, as an example, as I mentioned. Operation Christmas Child. I don't believe in Christmas. Therefore, I don't want children all around the world to get a shoebox with some toys in it and hear about the gospel and be prayed for and be led to the Lord. Because I don't believe in Christmas trees. I'll just let a potential ministry that lets millions of children hear the gospel every year. Let those people not hear the gospel because I hate Christmas trees. Stop making excuses of why you are full of hate and self-righteousness. Stop making excuses of why you're not serving God. Because God will make a place for you at the table. Just, you know, you want God to make a place for you to sit at the table and eat with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You want a place at the marriage supper of the Lamb. But yet there's no place for you to be to serve food. Jesus said when his disciples, the mother of James and John, Salome, she asked Jesus, you know, let it be that my sons would sit on your right and on your left. And Jesus went on to tell them a parable or a saying. He said that, you know, he will be greatest in heaven, will be the least on earth. So if you want to be great in the kingdom of heaven, then you'll be, you know, those who will be great in the kingdom of heaven will be your servant. I mean, the Lord himself washed the feet of the disciples. And he said, you see what I've done to you, you ought to do one to another. We're supposed to serve. Before you can be a leader, you must be a follower. You must stop trying to lead when God didn't call you to lead, or it's not your time to lead. You must follow first. You must learn to follow Jesus and those whom he would appoint over you, whether it be an established, you know, brick and mortar church, whether it be online under my ministry, or anybody, whatever the Lord would lead you to connect with Samaritan's Purse, as I keep mentioning, you know, whatever it may be that the Lord will lead you to connect with. And then there will be a day when the Lord will use you to disciple other people. But you must first be discipled. You don't start out as a leader and a teacher in God's kingdom because you got saved yesterday and you have some special revelation. Lots of people like that. Judgment begins within ourselves as we would present ourselves to the Lord as a living sacrifice. Even as the Bible says, the Word of God is a mirror. And we're supposed to behold our face in that mirror and not walk away. But be ye doers of the word. So when you see yourself steadfastly in that mirror of the word of God, James tells us, the half-brother of Jesus, he tells us that we must, you know, be conformed to the image of Christ. We must be a doer of the word. Let the word transform us. Not a hearer only, but a doer of the word. Brothers and sisters, I cannot stress this to you enough. I cannot stress this to you enough. 98% of the people in the church, in the body of Christ, are doing absolutely zero nothing. 2% of the people in the church are carrying all the weight. And brothers and sisters, they're serving. I've seen people, as I mentioned, this lawyer, this attorney, brother in Christ in Las Vegas. He's serving people. He's, you know, lots of people that, oh, I'm a lawyer. Oh, you know, I'm a doctor. I'm this, I'm a that. I don't have to do no work serving the Lord. God calls us to serve. The word minister means to serve. The origin of that word from the Greek and all that is a servant. To serve the Lord and his people. That's what ministers do. They serve the Lord and his people. And all of us are supposed to minister. Jesus said, minister one to another. Just as I did. I washed your feet. So you should do to each other. It's not just about a ceremony of washing feet. You know, some churches like the Primitive Baptists, they keep washing their feet. And there's nothing wrong with that. But it's symbolic. It's symbolic of serving. People's feet are dirty in those days walking around. As I mentioned in videos way back, 2 or 3 years ago, you're walking in the streets, stepping in cow poo-poo, then someone's going to wash your feet. It's always the lowest servant in the house that does that. But Jesus did it. Symbolic of you serving each other. We serving each other. That's what it's all about, brothers and sisters. I beseech thee, brothers, by the living God Almighty, that you offer your body in the mortar and pestle. That you offer your body to be cooked, to be put in the heat, in the test tube. That you might be a sweet-smelling savor. That God can do something with an old wretch like you. as the song says, you know, he saved a wretch like me. And you need to know that you also are a wretch. We're all wretches without Christ. A lot of you don't have that through your head. You think you're self-righteous. You need to be crushed so that sweet smelling savor can come out. So you can be a benefit to the kingdom of God. God didn't call you old to make man happy. God didn't call you to make you have a great day. God called you to bring glory to his name. He called you to serve him and serve his people and do his will. Whatever that may be, being a martyr, fed to the lions, crucified upside down, or to be the richest man in the world and build a million churches and give away 1 billion Bibles around the earth. Every person has their calling and destiny in Christ, and it begins. Once you offer yourself and you get born again, it begins right inside here. This is the places God's got for you. Get in the bowl. Get in here. Offer yourself and get in here. Then God can use you. Until you've been crushed, until you've been heated, until you've been tried in the fire 7 times, as the Bible says, you're full of dross. Go look that up, D-R-O-S-S. I used to work with molten lead in a battery factory between the time I got out of the army and started into full-time ministry. I did many years in the ministry, planted 4 churches, and at the same time I worked with hot mold and lead. In the summertime it was 120, 130, 140 degrees in there. And I worked with that hot lead, brothers and sisters. We had to dross it. Take this dipper and take the dross off the top of that melted lead. And the Bible talks about that. You have to be heated 7 times to have the dross taken out of you, to be purified in Christ. And we're all in that process. Until the day of the rapture or the day you leave this earth, you're going to be in that process. You'll never be perfect. But it's always a process with God. He always has a journey for you to take. As long as you're on this earth, you have a road to take. And it's a straight and narrow path. It's filled with deception. It's filled with serpents and vipers and demons and liars and false prophets and fools and stooges and God's people. And the wheat is there too. And God's beautiful salt and light children are there too. All of those things are on the straight and narrow path that leads into the kingdom of heaven, into all the glory, all the rewards that God has for you. That's why you got to have victory in Jesus. You know, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love goes to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I consider and sing the whole song. But the thing that you need to know is you got to be sweetly broken. Holy surrender. Hallelujah. At the cross you beckon me. You draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love, I'm sweetly broken. Holy surrender. See, getting saved, that's the problem with these oldies denominational people. Say it, mainly Baptist. You know, these other Presbyterians and all that, they don't even believe in getting born again. They don't even talk about it. So let's talk about evangelicals, like Baptists, some majority. Lead people to salvation, but to be born again, that's the beginning. Jesus called us to be followers of Christ, to take up your cross daily and follow me, to be broken, to be sweetly broken. Saying a sinner's prayer ain't being you broken. That's just repeating and babbling what somebody told you. It's all right here. Be sweetly broken. Be crushed on the Lord. What did Jesus say? You probably hear nobody quoting this text. There, right before the Lord went for his, after he had rode in Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, he was there and they kept challenging him, the Pharisees, Sadducees, and all that. And he says to the Israelites, as he said, that you're being rejected for not bearing fruit. Therefore, the Lord will bring a new people to himself who will bear much fruit for him. That's us, the Gentile church in the church age. What did he say? He said, don't you know that the stone that the builders rejected has been made the head of the corner, or the capstone? And it was marvelous in our eyes. What did he say? Those of whom fall on this rock, that's Jesus, rock of ages. Those who fall on this rock will be broken. But those whom the rock falls on will be crushed to powder. In other words, the judgment of God will crush you to powder if you're not broken. You must fall on the rock. Don't let the rock fall on you. That's a whole other sermon. I should have titled the video that. You know, don't let the rock fall on you and crush you to powder, but fall on the rock and be sweetly broken. At the cross you beckon me. You draw me gently to my knees. I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, holy surrender. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters. I ask you to pray with me right now. And I ask you to come in agreement with me that you're going to surrender your life to the Lord. Stop having delusions of grandeur, of all the things of, all these callings that you have in the Lord. Because God does call us, but we got to get there. You got to go through. You got to fall on the rock and be broken before God can use you. God uses broken vessels. I pray by the grace of God that you'll hear this word of God, this calling of God upon you. Get off the throne and let God on the throne of your heart. Get off the throne of your heart and let God on the throne of your heart. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, I know you're releasing a spirit of conviction, of holiness, of sweet surrender upon your people, Lord. Break the hearts of your people, Lord. Break their hearts, break their bodies, break their minds, Lord, from all kinds of delusions of the enemy, all kinds of delusions of grandeur, Lord God. Break the deception off of their hearts and minds and bodies, Lord. Let them be free in Christ to pursue your will, not our will, but your will be done, Father. Hallelujah. Let thy will be done in us as it is in heaven. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Lord. Let them have that moment. Let them have that moment in the garden of good and evil, Lord God. In midnight, for the midnight hour is here. Hallelujah. May you be found in Christ. May you have your oil in your lamp. The oil comes from the crushing. Hallelujah. That's a word from the Lord. In Jesus' name. I just got the word from the Lord that the oil. How do you get oil out of something? You got to crush those olives. The fruit must be crushed for the oil to come out. You know, you can get corn oil, peanut oil, olive oil. Reference to like the oil that I'm going to send people. The Lord just gave me that now. That oil also represents, I need to make a video about that, about all these things. The oil represents the crushing of the olives. The grinding of the olives. Thank God Almighty for His Holy Spirit. They will not be bound. That the devil can't keep us down when the delusions and the smoke and mirrors of the enemy has been removed. Hallelujah. May the spirit of deception be up off of you as the devil uses pride and arrogance and self-righteousness, self-condemnation on some, arrogance on others, pride on others. Hallelujah. To keep you from seeing yourself as you really are and seeing God the way He really is. Hallelujah. May your eyes be open. Hallelujah. And not darkened by the enemy, but opened by the power of the Spirit of the living God. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, may you have eyes to see what God wants you to see. Blessed be His holy name forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Praise and holy is His name. Righteous is His name. Worthy is His name. Hallelujah. He is the King of kings and Lord of lords. Soon coming King. Hallelujah. To deliver us from evil. Hallelujah. Deliver us from this fallen world. Hallelujah. To claim us as a bride without spot or without wrinkle. Hallelujah. To deliver us from this fallen world. Hallelujah. Blessed be His name. Hallelujah. Eyes have not seen or ears heard those things that God has prepared for those who love Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed be His name. Glorious is His name. Hallelujah. He has prepared a place for you and me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. John chapter 14. He has prepared a place for us. Hallelujah. He's coming to receive us unto Himself. Hallelujah. He is a mighty God. He is the King of kings and Lord of lords. Hallelujah. He's a deliverer. Hallelujah. He is the Alpha and Omega. Hallelujah. He is the Amen and the Amen. Hallelujah. The beginning and the end. Hallelujah. The first and the last. Hallelujah. To deliver us from this fallen world. Blessed be His name. Hallowed be His name. Glorious is His name. Hallelujah. He is the Savior, the Deliverer, the Redeemer. Blessed be His name. The word hallelujah is a Hebrew word that means praise Yahweh. Hallelujah, Yahweh. Blessed be His name. So praise Him. There are people that don't want to hear someone say amen or hallelujah, hallelujah. But hallelujah comes straight from the Hebrew, brothers and sisters. And it means praise Yahweh. Hallelujah. Praise the Father. Blessed be His name. Hallelujah. And blessed be His Son. Kiss the Son. Hallelujah. That the Father may receive you. Hallelujah. From the Psalm chapter 2. Kiss the Son. Hallelujah. that the Father may receive you. In Jesus' name, hallowed be his name. He is worthy of all praise. I love you guys. I love you guys. There's a difference between someone is patting you on the back like your mama does and gives you earthly love and pats you on the back to a coach, a mentor, someone trying to disciple you. It tells you the truth. That's agape love, sacrificial love. Tells you the truth in love. You think you're A, but you're really B. You need to do C to get to A. Because you're way over there in B, but you think you're at A, but you're not. Praise be God. May your eyes be open to what I'm telling you today. It's not by might nor by power, but straight from the Spirit of the living God. Straight from the throne of the Most High God. Be ye holy, for I am holy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come out from among these dead people. Hallelujah. And be ye separate unto me. A holy, peculiar nation. Hallelujah. That I've called. Hallelujah. For many are called and few are chosen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Choose this day whom you shall serve. Hallelujah. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Joshua, the last chapter. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name. Hallowed be his name. Hallelujah. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in me as it is in heaven. Let his will be done in you as it is in heaven. Hallelujah. Hearken. Hearken this day unto the voice of the Lord God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Hallelujah. He is able to the uttermost to deliver you from the snare of the foe, from the power of Satan, and transform you from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear Son, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Today is the day of your salvation. Today is the day of your deliverance. Today is the day for you to surrender all to Jesus. Give it up. Give it up. Give it up. Get off the throne. Hallelujah. Get off the throne of your heart and let Jesus rule and reign. Hallelujah. As the song says, Lord, we enthrone you, Lord. We proclaim you our King. Standing here in the midst of us, we lift you up with our praise. And as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. And as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. Let him take the place on the throne of your heart. Get off the throne. Hallelujah. 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 Get off the throne. A lot of you guys have turned the throne of the Lord in your heart into the bathroom throne. Just dropping a bunch of stinky mess on there. It's time to get off the throne and let the Lord make your heart a throne of honor. Hallelujah. As the throne of the Lord and the trail of his, of his veil fills the temple with glory. Hallelujah. Be filled with his glory. Hallelujah. Praise be God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name. Hallelujah. Let God be exalted. And Satan defeated. Hallelujah in your life today in Jesus' name. Know that the kingdom of heaven has come nigh you. When you surrender all to God, know that the kingdom of heaven has come nigh you. That Satan has been defeated. Hallelujah. That a miracle and victory has happened in your life as you surrender all to Jesus. Give all the territory to the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For when you think you stand, it's only standing in the power of the enemy. In deception. In fear and loathing. Hallelujah. In deception. Hallelujah. You are God of nothing. Either God is the God of your life or Satan is the God of your life. Hallelujah. You are God of nothing. Hallelujah. You're being deceived that you're your own captain of your own destiny. That you do it your way. It's deception, deception, deception from the pit of hell. Hallelujah. Be not deceived, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Hallelujah. Bring every vain imagination into captivity to the word of God. Amen. Don't say, I believe this or I heard this, but God said, hallelujah, this. Don't believe what you hear in this world. Don't believe what others tell you. Don't believe what your own mind's telling you. Don't believe what the devil's telling you. Believe what the word of God is telling you. Hallelujah. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. All who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whomsoever shall believe in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Hallelujah. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and God is raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Hallelujah. Can you believe the word of God? Hallelujah. Believe his words. Hallelujah. As he said, I am the Alpha and Omega. Behold, I come quickly, and my rewards are with me. Hallelujah. Be ready against the third day. Be prepared to meet the Lord in the air. Hallelujah. For he's coming for a bride without spot or wrinkle. Hallelujah. Be ready. Be ready. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. For he comes at an hour you expect not, when you least expect it. He will suddenly appear, hallelujah, in his temple. Hallelujah. As he said in his word, we are his temple. Christians are his temple. Hallelujah. He's going to suddenly appear. The Lord whom you sought will suddenly appear in his temple. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's going to deliver us from this place. He's going to deliver us from sea to shining sea. He's going to deliver us from the snare of the fowler. Hallelujah. He's going to pick us up and carry us away. Hallelujah. Come away with me, my bride. Hallelujah. Song of Solomon chapter 2. And his banner over us in his banquet hall is love. Agape. Hallelujah. He's coming for a bride. Be ready. Be ready. Have your oil. Separate the oil from the shell of that garlic in your heart right now in the name of Jesus. Blessed be his name. Get the pit out of your olive. Hallelujah, in Jesus' name. And let it be filled with the oil of his gladness. Blessed be his name.